Our next session, which is titled Freedom's Niece in Conversation with Nayantara Sahgal. And the moderator for this session is Mr. Salman Tarik Kureshi. Mr. Salman is, of course, a well-known English language poet and newspaper columnist who's been writing for many years. And he's been writing since his teens. His poems and stories have appeared in periodicals both nationally and internationally. And he has quite a few collections of short stories and poems published. So without further ado, I'll give the floor to Mr. Salman.
Assalamu alaikum, and how are you, Nayantara? I think I have to introduce somebody who's from one of the most leading families of the subcontinent. Nayantara Sahgal is the daughter of Vijay Lakshmi Pandit and Mr. Pandit, Mr. Sitaram Pandit. She is the sister, Mrs. Pandit was the sister of Jawaharlal Nehru, therefore the title Freedom's Niece. But it's not just that. Mrs. Sahgal is not just from a great political family and an intellectual family. She is a novelist who has written, I think, 9 novels, is it? Am I right? 9 novels over the years and numerous other books of biography, politics, and so on. Is this quite clear? No? As I said, numerous other books of biography, politics, and over the years. Mrs. Sahgal, I think, was born in 1927. She has seen the freedom movement of India and, of course, Pakistan, of the subcontinent, at very close quarters indeed. And I think she will talk about that with us in a few minutes. She will also, I would ask her to talk about her books, about herself, and about, well, to start with, I thought perhaps she could talk to us a little about her great uncle, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, and that great moment, midnight, August the 14th and 15th, when the age of imperialism ended and a new age was born. And Panditji gave that famous speech, which is perhaps one of the greatest speeches anybody has ever given. If you'll allow me, may I read a couple of lines from that speech? Panditji said, "Long years ago, we made a tryst with destiny. And now the time comes when we shall redeem our pledge, not wholly or in full measure, but very substantially. At the stroke of the midnight hour, when the world sleeps, India will awaken to life and freedom." And further on towards the end of that speech, "All of us, to whatever religion we may belong, are equally the children of India with equal rights, privileges, and obligations. We cannot encourage communalism or narrow-mindedness, for no nation can be great whose people are narrow in thought or in action." I beg your pardon. And that speech was the moment where that imperialism ended. I'll ask Mrs. Sahgal to talk to us a little about her uncle and that moment and that moment forward when the world's first post-colonial state was coming into existence and was being created. And I will ask her to comment on the idealism of that time, perhaps with its flaws, which are very visible even then, and the way things later evolved, particularly in the time of her cousin, Indira Gandhi. Can we take that as a starting point, Mr. Sahgal?
Yes, Salman, please call me Nayantara.
Nayantara, sorry.
We are here a gathering of writers and readers, and there should be no formalities amongst us. So, you were talking about the dawn of independence. I was in college in America at the time. And I came back to India about 2 months after independence. It was a very changed India from the one I had left as a very young girl. At that time, my uncle, Jawaharlal Nehru, and my parents had been in jail. They had given their whole lives to the struggle for freedom. And when I came back, my father had died of his fourth imprisonment under British rule. My mother had been sent as our first ambassador to the Soviet Union, and my uncle was prime minister. So I came back to a very different scene and setting from the one I had left. And as you can imagine, I was a very bewildered young woman on this new scene. But it was a time of great exhilaration and excitement, as well as a time of great grief and sorrow at what people on both sides of the border were suffering at the time of partition. So it was a very traumatic time in every way. And as you can imagine, a new nation had to deal with this highly traumatic situation at the same time as governance had to begin and India had to start functioning as an independent nation, first of all to free itself from colonial stagnation and get on its feet again, take measures to become self-reliant, and also in an international setting of Cold War, where America and the Soviet Union faced each other as enemies. And not only that, but each was competing for the support of the rest of the world. And in that situation, India chose not to become a client state of either superpower. And that set us on the path of our new foreign policy. And many, many changes were taking place within the country. The two non-negotiable things which happened at the time were secularism and democracy. Today, no Indian, no intelligent Indian will settle for any erosion of either secularism or democracy. So we established a very strong base for further development. And these things take time, and it was my uncle's endeavor to see that in his lifetime, this path was followed faithfully, and that India became strong in these respects. And he too realized that there was still far to go. When he died, there were some lines from the poet Robert Frost, which he had scribbled on a piece of paper which lay on the table beside his bed. "For I have promises to keep and miles to go before I sleep, and miles to go before I sleep." That was his view of how much was still left to be done, and that the Indians who came after him would then have this responsibility.
So the twin poles, secularism and democracy. But democracy took a nosedive in the time of your cousin when she was prime minister, the emergency. And I'd like you to talk about that a little, and also, of course, your novel, Rich Like Us, is set in the period of that emergency. I have some queries on that also, but would you like to comment on both of these?
Yes, all right. My cousin Indira Gandhi, as everybody knows, learnt a hard lesson through the emergency, she learned that Indians would not tolerate the destruction of democracy. Because when the next election was called, she was brought down in a tremendous defeat. She even lost her own seat in Parliament. And of course, the Congress Party lost out very badly. So this is why I say that democracy is non-negotiable. We are not going to settle for less at any time. And when she came back to power, that's another sign of democracy, that when the Indian people saw that the period in between, ruled by the Janata government, had not fulfilled the promises which they had made, and were a group which never became a proper coalition. There was infighting, there was competition for leadership, and therefore it couldn't last. And so the next election brought her back again in triumph. So I always feel that there are two things you can depend upon in life and in politics, and that is change. If you have a democracy, things are always going to change. And my novel, Rich Like Us, well, I opposed my cousin when she took this authoritarian trend and suffered several consequences thereby. But a few years after that, I wrote a novel called Rich Like Us. I'm a political novelist. All my novels have these political backgrounds or a political event of some kind. They're not about politics. They're about how the lives of people are affected by what goes on. So Rich Like Us was with the emergency as a background. And this is how a writer divests herself of her experiences, her joys and sorrows, you know, by putting them down on paper. And I got this whole very traumatic period out of my system by writing this novel, Rich Like Us. I hope some of you may at some time read it.
Well, for those who may not have read Rich Like Us, essentially it's about how people took advantage of the emergency, Indira Gandhi's emergency, to enrich themselves. And it's about how values of some individuals in it deteriorated, degenerated, and please correct me where I go wrong, and suffered. Particularly the lead character, or one of them, Ram's son, what's his name?
Dev,
that's right. Who becomes an opportunist trying to enrich himself in the circumstances. We have the civil servant who learns to just follow the rules. Yet we have also a civil servant, Sonali, who tries to resist. One of the things that was interesting that struck me, if I may say, was the character of Rose, who is Ram's second wife, and she is English. And she does try to uphold sound values, strong values all the way through. And she is murdered. Can I have your comment on that? Why is Rose murdered? Why must she die?
Well, Rose is an English cockney, a beautiful young English cockney who this Ram, who is a Punjabi businessman traveling in London during the 1930s, meets and falls in love with her and brings her back to India to marry her. He already has a wife and son. But in those days, in British times, there was polygamy, and a man could marry, a Hindu could marry as many wives as he wanted. So Rose has to learn to live with a co-wife in a very difficult situation. And she is the one who then identifies with the national struggle for freedom. Ram has no political interests. He's interested in his business prospering. But it is Rose, living in India, who not only makes friends with every class of Indian, she herself does not belong to the upper crust in England. So she can identify with people of all classes in India. And it is she who finally triumphs in the sense that she belongs to India even more than her husband. The reason why she dies, and I'm sorry that she had to die, but that's the way the story went. Her stepson has become a very corrupt businessman in close touch with the establishment.
That is Dev.
Dev. And Dev is then afraid that Rose knows too much about what he is doing, and so she has to go. So he arranges to dispose of her.
But is there some kind of metaphysical inevitability about the murder of virtue?
You don't
see it that way?
I have to say, Salman, that when you're writing a book, as I'm sure you know, once you put a character on the page, you are no longer in charge of that character. That character does what he or she wants to do. And there was, I put these characters on the page. I couldn't dictate to them, say this, do this. Not at all. The story evolves about what the characters want to do, not what the writer wants them to do. And there's a big difference there.
If that is something very important that you've just said, the character.
Yes.
The characters run the book, not the writer.
You know, there was a writer, famous American writer called William Faulkner, who once said, I have a hard time running after my characters, trying to keep up with them. And that's really the process of fiction. You cannot dictate what happens. The characters decide.
Where does the book come from? Do you think everything through in advance, or do you have a sketchy kind of feel for it and start writing, or how does it evolve with you?
As I said, I'm a political person. Why? Because that was the only material I had. I grew up in a political family. All around me, what was happening in the country was affecting our domestic life intimately. So I didn't choose that to be my political material or the subject of my fiction. It had to be my material because it was the only material that I had. And so I'm always what triggers off my imagination is this kind of thing, you know, what is happening in the country. That's why I'm thinking I should get back home and start a novel now on what's happening in my country now, because that's another new development. But I don't plan otherwise. As I said, I think, in my talk yesterday, I think most writers just stare out of the window until the right words come to them. And that's the process of writing.
T.S. Eliot, who was a poet rather than a novelist, said that writing consists of listening. That somehow the words will come from somewhere if you listen hard enough.
Well, I don't know how many of you were here when Jugnu was speaking earlier, and she said how much observation was important, listening to people, seeing people, because that somehow stays with you, and then you make something of it maybe years later. You know, one day you might get on a bus and you might see perhaps a woman who looks very old and tired, trying to carry a lot of bags full of stuff. And she may not make very much impression on you at that moment. 10 years later, that image comes back to you. And then you put her in a book. You don't put her in a book because you never put the fact in the book. But the fact gets you going and you take off from there and create your story, your fiction from that beginning.
You referred, and I'm happy that you referred to the emergency or Indira Gandhi's failure to sustain the emergency as an example of the resurgence of democracy. Because particularly I'm thinking of a number of third world countries in which I will not exclude the one we're sitting in, where strong arm rule and saviors riding in on horseback are considered the answer to society's problems, at least for a while, until they fail. And we've not yet had enough failures apparently here to move on. But I'm as happy you said, that was a failure of strong arm rule rather than a failure of democracy. But okay, I'll come to another set of problems later on. I'd like to move on to your novel, Mistaken Identity, which you referred to yesterday and which you read from. Something that struck me was, I've not read it in its entirety, but I have some idea about it. Bhushan Singh, the lead character, who, as you said, was yesterday, is neither a Buddhist nor a Hindu nor a Muslim or something of everything. Bhushan Singh's victimization begins with a series of coincidences. Correct?
A series of?
Coincidences. He happens to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. He happens to step out at the wrong moment. He happens to, and so on and so forth. And he finds himself arrested and tortured. There's no fairness involved in this, no right or wrong. It just happened. Is that how you saw it?
Well, it's
a mistaken
bit,
identity.
The mistaken identity is a bit of a satire on imperial rule. It's also a story of how one side of India was fighting for freedom, then another side of India, which were lining up with the British for the wealthy talukidars and all of the UP and other places. I also make a point of the fact that that region where Bhushan Singh's family lives and where he grows up is the cradle of Hinduism, Ayodhya, supposed to be the birthplace of Ram. But it is also, it has a huge heritage of Islam also. The monuments, the poetry, the dance. Last night we saw a beautiful performance of Kathak. Well, that has been Indian for centuries. Came from Islam, became Indian. So there are all these trends in the story that here is an India, partly servile to the British, partly struggling for freedom from the British. In the middle of all this, there's this young, very handsome young man, Bhushan Singh, who's good at ballroom dancing, you know, and he's a failed poet, a bit of a womanizer and all that. And he gets arrested for no reason at all. It's a case of mistaken identity. He gets pulled off a train in the middle of the night, dumped into jail with a bunch of communists and a decrepit old Gandhian and a couple of other younger Gandhians. And there he is in jail for about 3 years for no reason at all, because obviously he's not conspiring to overthrow the king emperor. He has absolutely no interest in politics. So that is what the story is about, a mix of all these things.
And it is also, therefore, the foolishness of imperialism. Imperialism itself, imperial system at the time mistook his identity and took it away from him and changed his life. The point I'm getting at is that the imperial system was run by the famous steel frame, of which the ICS at that time, later the CSB and IAS in India. I have a number of friends from the CSB sitting here. We won't comment on them. And your husband, your second husband, is a member of the ICS. Would you like to talk about both your marriages, if you would like to, the people?
That's much too big a subject. I don't think, you know, I could possibly.
Well, you want to know a little more about your life. You want to know a little more about your life. How it evolved.
Well, I let me only say this, that I've had a difficult life in many respects. It's been a troubled life because of certain causes I took up and certain beliefs I had, which I stood by. Maybe because when I was a very small child, I remember my father saying to me, if you see everybody running in the same direction, go the other way. It's bound to be more interesting. And I found this to be true. I've never been able to fall in line with what was considered the establishment view or the right thing to do. I've always made up my own mind and followed my own judgment. And in the course of doing so, I've run across a lot of trouble because I could not fit into the role of wife as a submissive person for whom the male is the lord and master and the woman has to fall in line with his wishes in every aspect. And I couldn't do that because I was brought up in a family where the men were the feminists. The men of the family were always telling the women. My father and my uncle were always telling my mother, yes, you can do this. It was she who was timid. Nahi bhai, main nahi kar sakti hoon. Mere saath chalo. And they would say, not at all. You go on and do it yourself. So it was the men who gave strength to the women to become feminists and to do jobs that only men had done before. I was brought up to see myself as an equal of men. And I thought of all women that way. And that didn't coincide with, in my case, the conservative Punjabi family into which I was married. And then that led, after many years, to a divorce. Then many years later, I married again.
Your second husband is also Punjabi.
What?
Your second husband is also Punjabi, right?
Was also?
Mr. Punjabi? Mr. Mangathrai?
Well, his mother was Bengali.
I see.
His father was from Multan.
So, okay, but not entirely.
Punjab was his home. His service was in Lahore as an ICS officer. And nothing for him has ever taken the place of Lahore. And, you know, that was his background.
Now, if I remember correctly, you confirmed that his sister was the principal of Canadian College in Lahore.
So principal of
some people, there may
first,
be some Canadians.
She was a student
here.
There, then she taught there, and she ended up as principal of Canadian College, yes.
And a number of us who were young men in Lahore in the 1960s had reason to tremble at the name of Mrs. Mangathrai. Yeah. So, because she was a stern person protecting her charges in the college.
Yes. So, and she was very popular with her students too, I believe.
Yes, I believe so. Yeah. I believe so. Okay, to move on a little, I wanted to come to you. I was still talking about mistaken identity in the civil service. Isn't it not just that he was mistaken identity, wouldn't this be inevitable in a system where, and talking about the inherent racialism of the colonial system, did it really matter to the colonial master if he had got the right person or the wrong person? Again, I'm slightly in the area of mysticism, but I'd like you to comment on that. Did it really matter for one darky or another? What did it matter?
No, that's not correct. And that is not how I intended it in the story. As I say, it was a bit of a satire that this playboy, this okay. handsome playboy who has no interest in life but ballroom dancing and meeting charming women, he should be dumped into jail. But it was a very serious time of famous conspiracy trials, as some of those who tried died in jail and became heroes of the freedom struggle. And the British were seriously concerned about political agitation as well as industrial unrest at the time. So it was not that anybody should be dumped into jail. It was a mistake, and he was let off in the end. And they all were, because none of them were involved in trying to overthrow the King Emperor at the time.
Okay, so it wasn't, as I read, as you were describing it, sorry, I hadn't read the book. Okay, coming to your next novel, the other novel I wanted to comment on, The Lesser Breeds is the most recent?
After that I went into nonfiction, so
that's right.
That
as
is the last novel, yes.
Now here we have the the non-violent approach. Again, it's your setting is colonial, and it's the non-violence of Gandhi versus the threat of violence, the possibility of violent methods being used to achieve freedom. And in a sense, doesn't non-violence prove to be a failure? A dead end. It doesn't achieve anything. Or is that how you read it? But equally violence.
I wrote that book as a tribute to a very remarkable period in Indian yes. history. Very remarkable. It was a kind of obituary to nonviolence.
Exactly.
It was remarkable because it was the first time in the history of any country that a war for freedom had been fought without violence. And the horror of it was that one side did have the guns. It was only one side that was nonviolent. Can you think of a more peculiar command ever given to troops as what Gandhi said to his followers? He said, if blood must be shed in this battle, let it be your own. So it was a very unequal fight, but it was great nonetheless. And I wanted to somehow, you know, put that down on paper so that it's never forgotten. Nonviolence certainly doesn't continue today in most parts of the world, but it does continue in many places, such as the young people who've stood up against Israeli guns in Palestine. Other movements like that, peaceful movements. You might say this little girl, this little Pakistani girl who's just got the Nobel Prize.
Malala.
Yes, she was up against guns, and she had the courage to resist. Well, this is a remarkable quality which continues in some movements, in some people. It hasn't died out of the world. But that particular moment in history in India was very remarkable. And that's what that novel is about mainly.
But as you said, Nayantara, in a sense, you wrote its obituary of nonviolence.
In a way, because where is it today?
Bits and pieces, maybe individual sparks here or there, but that's about
it. Yes, yes.
And then, so that I go back to how I started. Then, was nonviolence always fated to have its obituary written? To die, in short.
You know, the fact that something fails doesn't mean that it was not a good thing or that we shouldn't revive it and follow it. So nonviolence is an ideal that the world has to work towards, not only India. And we have to realize that war solves no problem at all. We have to banish war from the universe. And I think that time is coming.
Please, in fact, you're talking close to everybody's heart, but does it work? Does it work? Will it work? Can we abolish war?
Why not? At the end of a war, you've got to sit around a table and talk to sort out the peace arrangement. So do it in the beginning. Why have the war? Of course it can be done. Nothing is impossible.
Well, if it comes to that, war is an enterprise that is neither humane nor makes any economic sense at all. Even on any criterion, it doesn't work. Because you take over a devastated area after killing off a few thousand of your own people. But there it is. Nations continue to do it. Man, perhaps, is fundamentally belligerent.
You know, there is an Indian epic, which you all know, called the Mahabharata.
Yes.
And part of it deals with the battle of Kurukshetra, which is metaphorically considered a battle between good and evil, right and wrong, in which brother fights brother. It's the same family, and the two sides of the family are fighting and killing each other. At the end of the war, which of course is supposed to have taken place 5,000 years ago or more, nothing is left, nothing. It's the equivalent of what a nuclear blast would have been in 5,000 BC. What is the difference? Why you fought? You know, who was right, who was wrong? Nothing is left. What was the point of this massive destruction that leaves no one alive, nor anything to live for, and all the people you loved are corpses? You know, what is the point? So this is, I think, the next stage in human evolution, and I think we're getting there, where we are going to say, as many young people are saying in many parts of the world, no more war. We are not going to fight. It's possible.
Yes, that's it's a dream. I mean, you talked about like nuclear devastation. Sorry, with a little aside, I remember some years ago reading of some people visiting one of the islands where the Americans used to test their hydrogen bombs. And the only thing that they found living was some heavily mutated cockroaches, the only survivors of a nuclear exchange were cockroaches, the immortal creatures.
Terrible.
It's horrifying, the very thought, but yet we find mankind stumbling from one war to another, and we do find that when you're faced with people with weapons, by people with weapons, you need to respond with weapons. Is there an alternative to that?
No, well, I don't know. I'd like to say one thing about our epics, whether it is the Ramayana and Sita's role, or whether it's the Mahabharata. Many writers now are rewriting those epics fictionally, imagining them differently. For instance, about Sita, you might say, why should any woman copy Sita? What for? Here was this young girl, banished to the forest with her husband, lived a punishing 14 years of exile, was abducted, mistreated, recaptured, brought back, tortured, became pregnant, and then was left in the forest to die alone and beseech the earth to open and receive her because she had no hope left on earth. Indians are today asking, is that an example for women to follow? And in the case of the Mahabharata, similarly, brother fighting brother. The Gita itself says, do your duty, never mind the result. Is that a good idea? So we are, the writers amongst us, are rewriting these epics from a very different point of view. And that is something every society has to do. The Christians have done it. There are films made about Jesus, one I remember called Jesus of Nazareth, then there are others, which have depicted him as very human. No one has taken objection. This is the way that we evolve. We don't stay stuck in 5000 BC. We've got to get on with it and ask ourselves, was it right? Shouldn't we be doing something different? Should we copy Sita? Or should we remove that image and have another sort of woman arising whom we should copy? So all this is happening in literature in India. And I, of course, I said last evening, it's a very dangerous time for writers. And it is, because sometimes when you start criticizing what some people hold sacred, you may, efforts may be made to stop you. Nevertheless, we are going to go on writing.
Going back to what you said earlier, the two sort of rigid principles of democracy and secularism. We talked about democracy being compromised and then reasserting itself in India. Now we come to secularism. Do you see major threats to the fundamental secularist doctrines in India today? Are they not there?
Is secularism still there? No, there is many of us feel a wrong turn being taken today in India. Now, in a democracy, governments change, and they should change. That's part of democracy. Policies also can change, and they should change, to suit new circumstances. But what cannot change is the idea for us of India that we hold fundamental. And that idea of India is dedicated to secularism. India is a deeply religious country of many religions. Many religions have found their home there and have flourished there and are deeply respected there. So we are a devoutly religious people of many religions. And no religion is better than any other. They are all treated as equal. Now, we do not want a time to come when any religion, because it is a minority religion, feels unsafe. We do not believe. The idea of India is not one that the majority rules with threat and force. We don't want such a situation to arise. And I can assure you that no intelligent Indian is going to stand for it.
Amen, as I would say, that if indeed no intelligent Indian would stand for it. Are there enough intelligent Indians? I'm sorry, that may be an impudent question. But from the other side of the border, where we perceive what seem to be clear threats to your Indian secular doctrine, the rise of Hindutva, it's not comforting.
No, it isn't comforting to any real Hindu either. As many things which are being called Islamic are, I think, contrary to the spirit of Islam all over the world. So these are people who have diverted from true Hinduism, what you call Hindutva. It is not Hinduism. It is a belief that India should become a Hindu republic, that there should be no equality between the religions. There's been an attempt to what they call reconvert the minorities back to Hinduism. All this is absurd. It is wrong. And there's an outcry against it now. And I am convinced that India cannot give in to Hindutva, and that we will, if not very soon enough, see some change.
I've just been reminded that it's time for questions.
Okay.
But I'm going to be naughty about this and ask the first questions myself. And the first question is very simply from my side, others doubtless have their own. Is it possible in India to turn the clock back to the early idealism of Pandit Nehru's time, or to Gandhiite non-violence? Can the clock be turned back?
I don't think any clock should ever be turned back. What we have to do is move ahead. And I think idealism is a very strong part of human nature. There's absolutely no reason why it shouldn't be reasserted, and why Nehru's healing touch should not be there for us again in other people. After all, no country can rely on one man. It shouldn't. Each generation has to fend for itself, has to provide its own inspiration, its own idealism. We can't go back to some leader 60 years ago, you know. We move ahead with a generation whose foundation for growth was laid by that leader. Now, Nehru laid the foundation, and not only Nehru. It was a generation of leaders, Nehru and his colleagues, and the early governments of India, who all laid the foundation for secularism and for democracy. And the fact that they are dead makes no difference. The foundation is there, and India has grown upon it. So there's absolutely no reason why that should not be there still, or be reclaimed if by any chance someone tries to overrule it.
Yeah. We have a question here. This gentleman over here. Mics, please.
Thank you, Salman. My name is Hassan, H-A-S-S-A-N. I edit a publication, Investment and Marketing. First of all, we are delighted to have you here in Karachi and Pakistan. And we are so happy to listen to you last evening and today. I have two very brief questions, which is disturbing the minds of people today. First is, what in your view the limits of freedom of expression and speech? This has disturbed at the moment lots of people in different countries, and there have been two different groups going ahead. We would like to have your opinion about the freedom of expression and speech. That's one. And the second is, you said that the writers today are writing with a mind as horses to win the race. This is a statement you made yesterday. The writers are writing today, it seems, to win the race like horses. Does that go to be really true? And if it is, does it create a negative influence on the imagination and creativity of the writers today? Thank you very much.
I didn't quite say that. What I said was that the world today is ruled by commerce. That's the main impacting influence today. And therefore, it is also affecting writing, the world of literature, because all these prizes have come in. and it has become making writing something of a competition. I don't think writers are in the race for it, but it's this commercial atmosphere which has created this scene. I don't think in the end it bothers anybody. Real writers will write, whether they win a prize, whether they don't win a prize, it makes no difference. They have something to say, there's a strong urge to say it, and they will say it. I will also say that if there are going to be so many prizes, I would much rather that there were more prizes restricted to our region than international prizes which encompass every region. Because I think our region could really do with a few more prizes. Our writers perhaps are less well off than those in the West, and it might benefit them greatly, give them more time to write, to give up whatever other work they may be doing to earn a living. So all of this has good and bad effects. You know, it's not all going one way. But I was only referring to this era of commerce, where commerce has its influence on all affairs.
We have this lady here. Mike.
I'll be very brief and very direct. How do other members of your family, we've heard about Indira Gandhi, but I'm referring to her offspring and the offspring's offspring, and the offspring's offspring, the other part of the Gandhi family and the current incumbent in India, stand up to your personal scrutiny in the backdrop of the idealism that you have espoused?
Could you name names, because I haven't understood?
Rajiv, Rahul, Mr. Modi.
He's not
Priyanka.
No. Mr. Modi.
No, the first two, the other part of the family, and I added the name because it had come up, and I wanted to put a name to the the description that had already been painted.
Well, you know, I'm sure that children are not always like their fathers. They may be very different. Stalin's daughter was very different from Stalin. The same applies to maybe Churchill's children and other children. So it's not surprising if Nehru's grandson is very different from Nehru. Nehru had a very different upbringing, a very different experience of life. He spent nearly 10 years of his life in jail. He gave up everything for the struggle for freedom. Obviously, his grandson is not going to compare with him in character or in any other way. So that is not at all surprising. Why should anybody expect one's children or one's grandchildren to be exactly like oneself? They never are. As to Mr. Modi, he's not my family. I can't reply for him. I don't know why he is the way he is.
Lady here. Yes.
Thank you, Chairman. I was very pleased to hear your enlightened responses to Salman's intrusive questions. But my question, under the title of Freedom's Niece, is to you. I do realize that all the journalists come from the elitist section of the society. But I would like to know, has the common man in India achieved the extent of the freedom that it was imagined? I do realize that there is a process of democracy which goes every so many years. But what is the position of the man on the street? Is he free in all its aspects, in his actions, in his thinking, and in acquiring his rights? Thank you.
There's a very long way to go, but a little progress is made all the time, so that, you know, it's like if you're waiting in a queue, it's all right so long as you know it's moving. And in that respect, there is movement, there is social mobility. The class of people even in power today, the Yadav class, for instance, which are certainly not elite. At independence, it was a Western educated, English-speaking elite which took power. Today, it's the extremely middle class who own all the wealth and power. Even the Dalits have crorepatis amongst them. So all kinds of these movements are taking place. It's not standing still. And the other hope is that we have a very articulate and extremely open media who say what they like, investigate what they like. And much more is before the public about what needs to be done than ever could be before because of the new technological age that we live in. The news, all the other social media channels, so that people are very well informed from the highest to the lowest. And all these are good signs.
A mic over there. Over there. A gentleman.
Yeah.
He was there first.
Okay.
Dr. Jaipal Chhabria. I am a human rights activist and the president of Pakistan Hindu Forum. Madam, we welcome you in our country. You have come here. But my question is that the people of the both sides, India and Pakistan, have a good friendship, but the both countries' government think enemy to each other. Do you think, being an elder brother, India has tried good way to make a Pakistan good friend? If not, have you any suggestions?
Well, I am not a politician. I can't speak for what has gone right or what has gone wrong. All I can say is that there is tremendous goodwill for Pakistanis in India. When they come there, they are feted, they are treated with love and affection and festivity. And that applies to your filmmakers, your actors, your whoever it may be. And the same thing happens when Indians come to Pakistan. So at whatever levels, this goodwill, which is so genuine, can be encouraged and can be continued, we should do so. These festivals of literature are one way to meet, react to each other, even quarrel with each other. Why shouldn't friends quarrel? Let's have it out, much nicer than keeping it all inside one. And sports unite us, songs unite us. As I was saying last night, Kathak unites us, Shami kebabs unite us, There are so many ways and so many things that unite us that as people, we can't always account for what the politicians do, but as people, let's not let each other go. Let's be together.
There's a question over there, yes. Last question, because I'm reminded that the time is up.
Sure. My name is Ajay Pinjani. Thank you, ma'am, for being here. Ma'am, you said you wanted to write a book about the political circumstances going on in India right now. With the arrival of Aam Aadmi Party, I wanted to know, in your new narrative, what kind of significance will that take hold?
Well, first of all, the writing the book is still a matter in my mind. I haven't had time to sit down and think about it. And the other thing is that Aam Aadmi Party has just appeared on the scene. It hasn't had time to mature or to, take power anywhere. Hopefully, they may win the vote in Delhi. But it's too soon to see where they'll go. So I certainly wouldn't be able to put them in a novel. But otherwise, the scene as it is a very interesting scene. We're in a watershed politically. And it is a really very interesting situation for writers to write about.
Well, I think we've reached the end of our time. That remains for me to say at least I have had a very interesting discussion listening to you today and yesterday, and I think everybody will join me in saying thank you.
Nayantara. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everybody.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us. We will be having a two-hour break, and after which, at 8:30, we have our next program, which is a presentation by the Tehzeeb Foundation, Music Beyond Borders. Hope you will join us then. Thank you.